With more dangerous species lurking just beyond the veil of our solar system, and even worse creatures existing within a different dimension that could regularly pierce through the fabric of space and time and enter our universe, humanity had to become more than just a creature capable of adapting with our standard meat suits. As the years passed into the technological marvel that was the 20Ks, and then the downfall of Pinnacle in the 30Ks, humanity would enter a darker, more restrictive view of life in the 40Ks. Serving the God Emperor of mankind, humans still spread across the cosmos, building and claiming planets as their own. However, this future is fraught with orcs and essentially elves that would all like to see the human race topple from power. But humans gonna human, and naturally, the answer would be to create a version of humanity so powerful it's borderline ridiculous and almost makes them invulnerable to all forms of being bodied, sort of like how a common guardsman would be. So in today's episode, we will continue discussing the gene seed from Warhammer 40K. And this is gonna be volume 2, so I will link volume 1 at the top now if you would like to go watch that and get a nice opener as to what is actually happening in 40K, because, well, this is the most OP franchise I've ever seen in my life, minus the Doomslayer, that is. So with our first 6 alterations to the human form, this has given the soldier an advantage in combat not seen before in any other human. But as we continue, even more forms of invulnerability exist within the Astartes that would allow them to absorb the essence of their enemies and convert them into usable knowledge. Oh yeah, this is gonna get pretty metaphysical. The 7th of the gene seed organs imposed upon the human form is known as the preomnor. This organ would be located prior to the connection with the stomach, so along the area of the esophagus, more than likely above the diaphragm, as there was more room in the thoracic cavity available. When the space marine ingests anything that may be poisonous or even completely indigestible to the average human, they are able to either neutralize this poison by having the second stomach analyze and negate the effects of the poison. Obviously, this would be of great importance, as any would-be assailant would not so easily poison a space marine, ruining years of work. On top of this, one of two things may happen. Should the toxin be strong enough, the space marine will clear it from the system in the form of vomit. The second option is that the toxin will be taken to another specialized gland known as the Betcher's gland, which we will discuss a little later on, and how the space marine will use it. The stomach also offers them the ability to break down materials our bodies would not be able to. Our stomachs have a limit as to what they can do and what they can't do. Fibrous plant material, for instance, is not possible for us to break down utilizing the stomach acid that we have, but with a cow's 4 stomachs, they're able to receive nutrition from things like cellulose, along with horses and any other animals within that branch. With this second stomach, materials like this would be available for consumption, meaning that during battle, all plants are free game. That, coupled with the ability to negate toxic effects, means that the world is basically edible to these soldiers, keeping them fighting for longer. Next up, we have the augmentation that explains why some particular chapters are actually famous for consuming flesh of foes and drinking their blood as well. The omophagia, which is also known as remembrancer, is neurological in nature and related to the stomach. The omophagia is implanted directly into the spinal cord in the thoracic spine, where it is then wired to the stomach of the neophyte. These collection of nerves will branch off, run to the spine, and may even run to the cerebral cortex of this soldier. When flesh or blood is consumed by the Astartes, they will actually gain the knowledge of the consumed. Doing so can help them learn tactical information and aid them in battle further. However, how might this work? Well, it is known, or at least understood with current technology and studies conducted, that traumatic events may actually alter human DNA to a certain degree. Usually, DNA is pretty stagnant, except for, you know, mutations or invasions by viruses, but permanent changes are possible. This study is still in its infancy, and I believe it was just a few years ago that this connection was made, but with this basis then, perhaps our bodies are much more susceptible to the outside world and its influences. If this is the case, then all DNA is possible to be changed. So, operating on this assumption, when consuming the DNA of another fallen foe, assuming that the rest of the species maintains its constant, which is DNA, then perhaps certain patterns arise within DNA, allowing the reading and understanding of knowledge through that DNA housed. Again, a little far-fetched, but regardless, the organ allows for the partial understanding and reading of this knowledge. It's not all benefits, however. Certain mutations have arisen through the years, leading to some issues, giving certain chapters an unnatural craving for flesh. And I mean, don't get me wrong, I like a good steak, but when it comes to eating long pig or an orc, I think I'd probably have to pass. Eating native creatures of a planet, however, would be quite beneficial, as this would give the Astartes survival information, as well as what this creature did before its ultimate demise. The next augmentation is why my health teacher in high school quite literally said he would write a book about all the random questions I asked about alterations to the human body. This implant is known as the multi-lung, or the imbiber. When a space marine touches down in an environment, they may or may not have great atmospheres. To counter this, the third lung is implanted into the chest cavity and will help them bring in more oxygen in oxygen-poor environments. Along with this, sphincter muscles are added that can close off the original lungs should a poison gas be dropped on the soldiers. The third lung will remain operational and filter out the poison. poison while still taking in oxygen. Although at this point the body is running at a reduced capacity due to oxygen demands, and only one functional lung is performing the action. But this will allow the Space Marine to continue fighting in environments where normal humans would fall. The next augmentation actually relies on normal growth functions of the body, much like the hormones in Volume 1, which I talked about how the bones were grown in neophytes. This augmentation is known as the oculobe. This implant will sit at the base of the brain. Along the inner and lower portion of your brain sits the optic nerve. The optic nerve will run to the back of the eyes, and then from there, run to the occipital lobe, which is located at the back of the skull. Most visual information is processed here, which gives us sight. Which also, interesting fact, everything you see is flipped, but upon the information reaching your brain, it is processed as right side up. Sometimes with migraines, your brain isn't able to process this incoming information correctly due to inflammation, and the image will be interpreted how it is seen, meaning that people will see upside down if their migraine is bad enough, which honestly, that sounds completely horrifying. But enough of that, this particular organ is responsible for the front end of this information collection. Utilizing the optic nerve as a sort of conduit for information, which is really what its purpose is, it will interpret this and make adjustments accordingly to the eye. In your eye, you have the retina, which senses incoming light information and then relays it. Moving closer to the retina, you would find it's actually made up of cones and rods. Rods are responsible for allowing us to have some night vision, albeit it's not that great, but it does allow us to see in low light environments. Cones allow us to see in colors and are typically associated with brighter light. And again, rods are more numerous and more sensitive to light, but you cannot see color, just as sort of a side note. With this organ operating in the eyes, the Space Marine can increase the amount of cones and rods at will. This would allow them to see with better acuity during the day, well beyond what a human is capable of, and also give them much better night vision at night, or when they're underground, or when the sun blows up, or really anything. But they can increase the amount of rods in their eyes in response to darkened environments. The next alteration is one that if you've ever experienced tinnitus or vertigo, you know very well how debilitating it can be should it happen, and why it's an absolute liability should you be hit with this during combat. Lyman's ear completely replaces the original ear of a neophyte and will absolutely negate the ability to cause dizziness and motion sickness in the Space Marine. Dizziness and motion sickness come from the inner portions of the ear known as the vestibular system. These collection of canals sense movement and report to the brain as far as what you are experiencing. Should this be in conflict with the eyes and what they are currently reporting, this can cause you to become extremely unbalanced or feel sick. With Lyman's ear, presumably, this would be a complete removal as organics fail. Instead, this new organ will report to the brain and subsequently give it information on positioning at all times and maintain the correct placement and location in space. Due to this, no misinformation will ever be reported, meaning that the Space Marine will never experience what other soldiers may. This would be invaluable as after taking anything like a blast or a concussive hit, this can shake up the vestibular tubes and knock a person off balance, leaving them exposed. But this is not something that altered humans have to worry about, meaning that they can continue to fight. And on top of this, they are not affected by the shaky spacecraft or violent changes in G-force, so to say I envy them is kind of an understatement. The Susan membrane is also referred to as the hibernator, and this is the 12th augmentation. I know I really haven't been keeping track of those numbers, but now you know where we stand and where we have yet to go. This particular organ is actually one that is implanted into your standard man to become a neophyte. Placed in the cranium of this person, it will eventually merge with a cerebrum and become part of the naturally occurring architecture of the neural network. However, it will require chemical therapy to actually activate this organ. This is a limiting technique, as should you fail or run away from the process or the program, the organ you have received will do nothing and you will still be completely average. The purpose of this organ is to put the body in a state of suspended animation, either through conscious choice, say should you be on a very long trip or setting off a rescue beacon and are stranded and must wait for help, or due to severe physical trauma. The latter happens for two reasons. The first reason is suspended animation may actually appear as if the Astartes has fallen. Undoubtedly, with all the others around them, those in suspended animation can be salvaged for later, and there's also the added benefit that they will likely be ignored by the enemy. The second reason is when you're in this state, biological processes move much more slowly, almost at a standstill really. The body will use less energy, much less energy, and require virtually no intake of nutrients to stay alive. This suspended animation can last as long as it needs to also. The longest a battle brother has gone was 567 standard years after severe injuries, and then he was successfully revived. To revive an Astartes, you must receive appropriate chemical therapy or hypnotic autosuggestion, otherwise the Space Marine cannot be roused. Now, we talk a lot about mutations happening on this channel, and more specifically the mutations that can arise within the Astartes. To help mitigate these issues, the next augmentation, known as melanchrome, provides some protection by natural abilities. This implant is connected to the lymphatic system of a person and acts as a hormone to influence the body's melanin production on a scale far greater than that of your average human. So when you go into the sun, UV radiation immediately begins causing mutations to your skin's DNA and can also create things known as thymine dimers, or a connection between close thymines. This can cause things like skin cancer to develop. A way to protect the nucleus of a cell and subsequently the DNA is melanin production. With more melanin clustered over the nucleus, UV radiation has a tougher time getting through to cause these issues. This is why we see darker skin located closer to the equator of our planet, as there is more direct sunlight and subsequently more direct exposure to UV radiation. At higher latitudes, we see lighter skin as the sunlight is more indirect and melanin isn't as necessary to form. This same process is used in the Astartes. Different chapters will have different skin colors as a result of varying levels of UV radiation and other radiations they may be exposed to. This can range from unusually pale skin of the Blood Angels to their similar chapters, and then go to the very dark black skin and red eyes of the Salamanders as they are exposed to greater levels of radiation. Now, I have mentioned the poisoning of Astartes a few times at this point, and while the organs are in place to actually filter out this poison, what happens should a poison or sickness enter the body through another route other than being ingested or inhaled? Say something like an open skin abrasion. It would be quite the issue if there didn't exist a method to clear the body of these toxins, and for that, of course, there is an answer. The oolytic kidney. This kidney is referred to as the purifier and is almost an emergency measure. This organ is implanted into the abdominal cavity and works in conjunction with your naturally occurring kidneys on a day-to-day basis to filter out the enhanced circulatory system naturally. However, should a poison or toxin too powerful for the rugged immune system or countermeasures to clear be introduced into the system, the oolytic kidneys can be activated to its full potential. The issue is, however, this kidney requires the complete shutdown of consciousness. For this organ to function at its increased rate and quickly gather up the ailments, an Astartes will have to go unconscious for a limited amount of time until the body has been cleared. Clearly, this can be very dangerous in combat and could lead to their detriment, but considering the alternative is 100% assured demise, this would be a preferable measure. So as humans have evolved over time, it became more favorable for us to use our brains and our sight to hunt prey. We ditched the more primitive traits such as tracking by smell in favor of these other senses. We made up for our shortcomings of, say, the poor sense of smell by domesticating wolves and using them as hunting partners to cover our weaknesses. This, however, has rendered our sense of taste and smell to be much less of that than what it could be. To counteract this, the neuroglottis is implanted in the upper nasal passage, which serves many purposes. The first purpose is to assist the Astartes in the ability to determine if something is edible or toxic. The sense it puts off can be interpreted as such, and you may be interested to know that we actually have a function like this now. Your sense of taste is broken up into sweet, salty, sour, savoriness, and bitter. Bitter is of great importance, as typically things that are toxic to humans will taste bitter. Ironically, we now actively drink things that taste bitter, but it's how our bodies determine, wow, I really don't like this, I'm just gonna go throw this up just in case. Which also, another fun fact about that, when you watch other people throw up, the reason you wanna throw up is because it's social adaptations. If you're hanging out in a cave with the other caveman, and not too sure if you should eat that caribou, but your friend does, and then he starts throwing up, but you had just taken a bite of it, your body's gonna be like, oh, that's not good, and then you're gonna puke too. But in a sense, the Astartes also have an enhanced version of this sense, and it also works with their sense of taste as well. Should something be unsuitable, they will quickly evacuate it from their meat suit. The second purpose is that their sense of smell increases to that of a canine companion. The human olfactory bulb is responsible for interpreting this information and is actually relatively small, as we didn't really have to use it, so it never became as developed. But with this implant, the workload is shifted to it rather than the olfactory bulb, so they're able to sniff out enemies well beyond what a human could. So this means that orcs smell even worse than normal. The next augmentation is one that is also an emergency use, known as the mucronoid, or weaver. This is given to an adolescent and implanted into their central nervous system. When done, this particular implant will only react to certain chemical stimulants as not to be active all the time, as this could begin to wreak havoc upon the skin. The body will secrete a waxy substance that protects itself during periods of suspended animation. Not only would this help maintain the moisture levels internally for the long haul, but it's also so potent it can actually protect soldiers from the perils of the vacuum of space. So by natural logic, it can also keep them safe in deeply frigid environments. This substance would be imperative to many altered, as without it, going into suspended animation would only allow them to survive as long as the moisture levels were maintained, which by evaporation would be extremely difficult on a hot planet, or should they be mortally wounded on a freezing planet, this can help them stave off frostbite so they do not end up losing limbs in the process. The next organ, and I told you we would return back to it, acting as an enhanced version of our own salivary glands, this gland is known as Boettcher's gland. Believe it or not, saliva is actually the first stage of digestion. Mildly acidic, it will coat the food and begin breaking it down, at least for some of the easier components, as well as lubricating it as it heads heads towards the esophagus. In the Astartes, it's turned up to 11. Two of these glands are implanted into the mouth, either inside the lower lip, in the salivary glands themselves, or in the hard palate. With these two glands working together, they can produce extremely corrosive acid that can help break down cellulose in terms of digestion, or as a last result, be used to blind, wound, or body an enemy should it be spat in the right location. This acid can be formed from some of the toxins that they may pick up along the way, which are filtered out of the body and then sent to the Betcher's gland. But due to the acidic nature of this gland, it can be assumed that the mucronoid gland may also have a continuous presence over the skin inside of the mouth as to protect the Astartes from digesting and damaging themselves. The next alteration is perhaps to counteract the fact that it is assumed Space Marines and Astartes are actually sterile. Now, before you get up in arms, this is not 100% confirmed that they are, but it's highly likely through chemical changes to the body as well as indoctrination that they go through that they are sterile or at minimum celibate, as they are there to serve the glory of the Emperor, not their biological base or needs. Because of this, an implant known as the progonoid gland are implanted into the adolescent Space Marine. That being said, it is customary to harvest the cells from the glands after expiration of the Space Marine. This form of reproduction will ensure that they continue on despite their falling. These cells will be used to pave the way for the next neophyte, as this line remains immortal despite the perishing of an individual. The final and most important augmentation is known as the Black Carapace. This is what ties everything together and makes the Space Marines such unstoppable machines. What's better than wearing heavy armor? Wearing heavy armor that reacts and thinks as fast as your brain does. During the transformation from neophyte to superhuman Astartes, the Space Marine carapace is cut into and black organic fibrous material is implanted directly under the skin. This material will invade the Space Marine's body, leaking up to the central nervous system. It's clear it would more than likely be drawn to the electrical activity taking place, and upon reaching it, it will develop pathways onto the CNS to begin relaying information. The suit has the ability to connect to these fibers after a few hours once they harden. And here's what separates specifically the Space Marines from others. The power armor they wear contains the machine spirit, or AI, which interfaces with the human brain. Upon doing so, the suit will move as they do, react as they do, and bolster itself accordingly. This provides greater protection and more abilities to the individual wearing it. It should be noted, however, that this connection is not required to move the power armor. Others are able to wear armor such as the Sisters of Battle and some Inquisitors, but because their central nervous system is not linked, they are slower and more cumbersome, as well as less effective at protection than specifically the Space Marines. But with these augmentations wrapped up, I think now is the perfect time to tell you that I do plan on going into excruciating detail with each augmentation in its own video. How it's implanted, what are the effects, how the body responds, and what's the ultimate outcome, because medically, these are pretty fascinating. So that's gonna do it for me, guys. I hope everyone enjoyed Volume 2. If you did, leaving a like would help, and also would be pretty bro of you, and subbing is a great way to stay up to date on when I post. I'll drop my Twitter, Discord, Patreon, and second channel links if anybody is interested in that. And I swear I will be posting a video here soon on that second channel. I just need to start waking up at 5 every day to get it done. But speaking of patrons though, I would like to thank mine. Of course, we have the absolute unit, It's Not a Spoon, holding down the astronaut tier. Thank you for your continued support, my dude. Next up, our scientists are Freedom Units 44, Skilt, and Trey Windenall. Huge thank you to you as well, guys. And to the rest of my patrons, you are greatly appreciated. Your help goes a lot further than you might actually know. All right, so that does it for me. I hope everyone enjoyed, and I will see y'all in the next one.